هو أحد السبيل. صدق الله العلي العظيم. Cultivating a divine disposition has been our ongoing topic. Tonight is lecture number nine. Up until now, our discussion has been revolving around the past two or three nights, around the awamil of this discussion on the shakila. Those factors that help us to achieve this goal that I'm trying to set for myself and maybe all of you, to leave this ashra with at least a resemblance of a divine disposition. And we talked about things that were external the past 2 days, the spouse and the children. And today and tomorrow, as I close out the ashra before Friday, I'm going to turn the discussion inward. And we're going to speak a little bit about ourselves for the next 2 days. Friday, of course, the day of Ashura. Saturday, my last lecture. Thank God, right? We will tie the Imam of our time to Shakila to close out the ashra, inshallah. One loud salawat ala Muhammad, ala Muhammad, please. You see, I want to start off, and today I'll take you on a journey through various ayat of the Quran. And I'm going to start off with Shaitan, a classic story that all of you know from the Quran, but a little bit through the lens of the Shakila, inshallah. You'll get to my point, and then we'll talk a little bit about Hijrat today. Before that, however, let's dive right in. I don't have much time. Again, we have Masaib that's heart-wrenching tonight for Ali Akbar. And I want to make sure I get my point across. Let's start off with the classic discussion or the classic verse from Surah Baqarah, where now Allah describes this moment. وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ When we said to the angels, أُسْجُدُ لِآدَمَ Okay, bow down to Adam. Everyone did, إِلَّا Iblis, except for Iblis. أَبَا وَأَسْتَكْبَرَ وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ Okay, he rejected, he refused, he was proud, he had kibr. And then Allah uses an interesting ending to the verse. He says, he was amongst the kuffar, amongst the disbelievers. And the tafsir now tells us, and again, Alama's tafsir tells us, there's a little bit of a hidden meaning here at the end of this verse. It's a classic verse, all of you understand, you know this story very well. He didn't do sajda. But Allah says that it's not that at that moment he became an unbeliever. That disbelief was always hidden inside of him. Because the tenses that are used, and this is where Arabic grammar is so crucial in looking at the Quran. Every word, every tense of the verb, every letter, every zamir, everything that's used really kind of gives us a good understanding of what Allah meant by this verse. He goes from a command, usjudu, which is a very present at that moment command, to a fi'li mazi. Kana is a fi'li mazi. It's a past tense verb. It's not possible that at that one moment where Shaitan now did that one mistake towards Allah, that from that one mistake or that one refusal to follow one of Allah's commands, he all of a sudden became amongst the kafirin. That's not becoming of a Lord that has mercy. There was something else. And that something else, now this is where we use the Quran bil Quran. One of the most beautiful methods that Allama uses for tafsir is Quran bil Quran. He uses one verse to explain another. It's an incredible methodology for tafsir. Let's go towards Surah Hijr. Surah Hijr has a little bit more details about this story between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Shaitan. Actual conversation, a little bit of back and forth between Shaitan and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah gave him a chance to actually explain himself. When I commanded you, God says, no one else did. I commanded you, why didn't you do such that? Now there is one moment in this surah, not up there yet, on the surah where he flat out says, "Ana khayrun minhu," I'm better than he is. Okay? He's teen, I'm not. He's dirt, I'm fire. Very specific conversation between him and this specific Adam. But the verse that I believe it's verse number 33, does not talk about individuals anymore. He goes further to describe why he couldn't do sajda to Adam. And this was very important for us to establish first thing tonight. So right off the bat, I need you tonight, inshallah. He says, "Qala lam akun li asjuda li basharin." Li basharin. I can't bring myself to do sajda to a bashar. He goes from Adam, he goes from dirt, he goes from this Adam to all of a sudden now a kulli overall principle. Especially he says, since what? Khalaqtuhu min salsalin min hama'in masnoon. Especially since you created this bashar from this dirt. And he really reduces this dirt down to this dark and really unpleasing dirt that you did what? Masnoon to. That you actually created something out of that. You shaped this Adam, this bashar, from this dirt. But the interesting part of this verse is lam akun. I can't bring myself to do sajda to li basharin, for this bashar, for any creation. No longer is it a talk about Adam. Now he says, I can't. I can't allow myself. And lam in Arabic is not la or ma. Lam means that it's a hard no. I can't. I can't. I can't be false to my zamir, to my conscience. It's like when Imam Hussein, alayhi salatu wasalam, Allahumma salli ala. He went from denying bay'at to Yazid to expressing that tarikhi and historical jumla and that statement that someone like me can't give bay'at to someone like you. No longer is it Yazid and Hussein. There's a principle that he stood forth. Even if whatever, you try to convince me, my shakila won't let me give bay'at to you. My disposition won't let me give bay'at to you. Shaitan in this verse is not saying Adam, Adam, Adam. He's saying my disposition, me. I can't allow myself. I can't see myself. I can't let myself do sajda to something like this. So now no longer is it an issue of that one instance, right? There's a principle here that Shaitan flat out says. And that's why Allah says, look, this kufr, this disposition now to rebel, to go against me, was always in Shaitan. It was always in Shaitan. Now Allah says, do sajda in front of Adam, knowing full well he has to fight his disposition. This is not just a random, okay, you come and you come, oh, Iblis, I'll be ajaye. Are you bet here? Come, have a seat. This is Adam, say hello, yeah, now do sajda. No. Allah has wisdom. Allah is Hakim. He knows there's a bimari inside of Shaitan. There's a nux inside of Shaitan. There's a deficiency inside of Shaitan. And I'm presenting him a chance to fight that disposition, that taghutiyah nature, to fight that ego and do sajda in front of this bashar. When in actuality, it's a sajda for me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Shaitan says later on in Surah Hijr, when Allah says, okay, you've reduced this now to clay and fire, you're out of my kingdom, out of my garden. Out. Then he says, bima aghwaytani. It's a very powerful statement. He does what? He blames Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Follow very carefully. He blames Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying that you knew that in the heart of my heart, I couldn't bring myself to do what? To do sajda to this bashar of yours, and yet you still asked me to do it. You set me up. It's called gaslighting nowadays. You poke the bear and then you complain the bear attacked. You asked me, you knew that I had this nux inside of me. You knew for a moment that I wasn't going to lower my ego and my kibbut and my pride to bow down to this bashar that's made of salsal and this dirt. But yet somehow you still asked me. And now you're surprised that I said no? So sometimes our tests that Allah gives us, sometimes the difficulty, sometimes the challenge is very specific to you and I. This was a command of sajda, very specific for shaitan, to pull that lam akun out of his heart, to change his shakila towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, in the bilquwa phase, in the potential phase, it was up to Adam to actually go, up to shaitan to actually do sajda, to convert to the actualization of it. So these are not just simple stories, oh, he didn't do sajda, so, no. There is actually wisdom behind there. Now you'll ask me, wait a second, hold up. What happened to those 3,000, 4,000 years of ibadat? Yeah, good question. After 8, 9 nights, I can read minds now, mashallah. What happened to that ibadat? Nah, let's talk about that. What shaitan now? No doubt, shaitan for thousands of years worshipped Allah. He was the pride of the jinnat. In Farsi, they say he was the ta'us of the jinnat. Ta'us means a peacock. They use that for beauty. He was a beautiful jinn, man. This was like he was the head. He was the pride, and he was the source of envy and jealousy in a positive way of many of the jinn, many of the Ahl al-Sama in the heavens. Thousands of years he worshipped. And understand this very delicate point, I'll move on. Shaitan, no doubt, for thousands of years was an abid of Allah, but not an abd of Allah. It's one thing to worship Allah. It's one thing to be subservient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the difference between Ayn Alif Baal Dal and Ayn Baal Dal is one Alif. And sometimes in Irfan, they take the Alif to symbolize the pride of the human being. Stand alone, straight, doesn't bend, doesn't have a dot, it doesn't even join in the beginning. It's actually referred to as a stubborn letter inside Tajweed sometimes. It refuses to join in the middle, in the beginning. It's stand alone. I'm alif, I'm stand alone. The problem was shaitan never removed the alif from his abid. So now the scary part for someone like me is, I could be for years now worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being an abid, 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 but when is that subservience going to come? When Allah asks me to do something that might go against my shakila, knowing full well He's asking me because He knows it's inside my shakila. Now I could sit there and take the comfort way out, say, God, I can't do it, I'm sorry, it's too hard for me, I don't want to do it, I won't do it, I can't see myself doing it. So someone like me can't wear hijab, someone like me can't go for hajj, someone like me, you can do all that and continue to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but all you'll do is an abid or an abidah for my sisters. But what Allah wants is an abd and ubudiyah and subservience from all of us. So having all those years and years and years of worship, shaitan had this what? Lam akun. I can't bring myself, meaning what? I can't lie to my shakila and now do what I thought I would never do and bow down to Adam. To the point where in Bahar, Nabi Musa asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Nabi Musa is an incredible prophet. Kalimullah is a beautiful laqab. It's not just one who spoke to Allah. It's the one who looked for excuses to speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he would present questions and scenarios that were mahali in nature, impossible in nature. You know, sometimes someone really wants to talk to you and they're enjoying that conversation. They don't want it to end. So they bring up, you know, random facts and maybe, you know, suppose this and suppose that. What about this? What about that? Just to keep that talk going. That's how Nabi Musa was. The immense love he had for Allah to the point when they were conversing, however they were conversing, he didn't want that to end. So he'd ask them, Allah, suppose, farz-e mahali, we say in Farsi, that these, you know, these situations that are impossible. So for example, one of them is that if you were a creation, Allah, if you yourself were a creation, how would you spend your time on this earth? Great question, right? Allah says, I would do khidmat of the people. I'd be a khadim of the nas, of the people. One of them, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that if shaitan now does tawbah today, would you accept it? He says, of course I would. Tell him to go to the grave of Adam and do sajda to the grave of Adam. It's not that simple now. And the purpose is not to sit there and make shaitan fail after fail after fail. He wants to now remove that bimari inside his shakila. Years and years later, thousands of years later perhaps, maybe shaitan had a moment to think about it. Maybe he softened a little bit. So Musa goes to shaitan, says, look, there's still a chance. There's still a chance. Go to the grave. The grave is in so-and-so location. Go and do sajda. And shaitan, lam akun, I can't bring myself. He says, I didn't do sajda when he was alive. You want me to do it when he's dead? We have to examine ourselves. And the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places things in our life that sometimes are uncomfortable. And I want to segue that into a very important voice, a verse, the 100th verse of Surah An-Nisa. Before that one, salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, please. This verse is very important. I'm going to break it down a bit by bit. I'm going to take my time with this verse. It's extremely important. There is a zahir of the verse, as you know, a batin of the verse. There are levels of each verse. And the beauty of the Quran and the beauty of the tafsir that we get from the Ahlul Bayt is that they give us a little bit of a glimpse of the deepness of the Quran. This verse is like that. I'm going to pick up the verse about a quarter way into the verse. وَمَنْ يَخْرُجْ from that portion. It's on there, you guys with me? Pretty beautiful. Now the whole premise is, and let's go ahead and read the Arabic, a little bit of the translation, and figure out what these words mean, because they have a zahiri meaning, but I want to go a little bit deep with all of you tonight and go through the batini meaning. وَمَنْ يَخْرُجْ مِنْ بَيْتَتٍ مُحَاجِدًا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ يُدْرِكُهُ الْمَوْتِ فَقَدْ وَقَعَ أَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ كَانَ اللَّهِ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمًا. And Allah Ghafoor Rahima? Yes. Now, on the outside it says, for the one now who leaves their home in the state they are a muhajir, that they are somebody who is a migrant, who does hijrat, ilallah, towards Allah and his prophet, Rasuluhu and his prophet, and on the way during that migration, they pass away. ثُمَّ يُدْرِكُهُ الْمَوْتِ. There is a reward waiting for them from Allah. Okay? The outward has a lot of gaps in it. I don't quite understand what that means. If we take it for the zahir, that might mean that, okay, I boarded a flight to leave my country to come to this country, let's say, for example. On the way, I'm moving because I want to set up a nice environment for my kids to grow spiritually, I guess. So I'm on the flight, and God forbid the flight goes down. And God says, there's a great reward waiting for you. For what? For boarding the plane. For flying the plane. For leaving my house. Where what did I do in this verse on the outside for Allah to say, Ajruhu Allah. Allah, not ma'Allah, Allah. Yani it's with Allah. Meaning what? Allah now is bound to give it to you. Let's go a little bit deeper. For the one who leaves their home. Okay. Look, when you're on a journey, you're traveling. And let me explain a little bit, then go back to the verse. Maybe you'll see it differently, hopefully, inshallah. When you're traveling, when you're about to travel, let's say, for example, you're about to board your flight, the flight's in, let's say, 6-7 hours, and I come by and I stop by, let's say, to say my goodbye, say my khalafis, let's say you're going for Hajj, let's say you're going for Arba'in, let's say, for example, whatever the case may be, I come by, I say my khalafis, I give you my du'as, and that's it. I walk in now, the flight is 6 hours from now, you're leaving for Pearson in 2 hours or 3 hours, I walk in, you're on the sofa watching some nahas, in your t-shirt and pants. There's no suitcase, there's no running around, I don't see a passport, nothing. There's no sign of a travel, no sign of a journey. Otherwise, 2 hours before such an important journey, you're running around, you're wearing your suitcase, you're making sure you have your passport, the suitcases are by the door, right? There's all sorts of hustle and bustle, who's coming to the airport, about yelling and screaming maybe in the most polite way, all these things, right? There's actually some movement. You could tell there's a journey about to happen. There are signs and alamat of safar, of journey. And that's for a physical journey. For a spiritual journey, and that's where I want to start in this verse. The verse talks about the idea that your safar, your khuruj from your bates, the exit from your home, in the state that you are a muhajir. But it actually tells the destination of your hijrat, ilallahi wa rasulihi. You're migrating towards Allah and His Prophet. And I'm going to make sure I mention why God says and His Prophet. It's extremely important. But Allah says this is not a journey towards some physical destination. So let's take that away from the zahir of the verse. This is a spiritual journey. What's meant by bait? What's meant by maut? What's meant by ajr? Why did Allah include the Prophet? Let's go through that one by one. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, please. Imam Khomeini rahmatullah alayhi has a beautiful discussion in his Adab al-Salat. He talks about the sair and suluk of the human being. Many of the urafa, especially Imam Khomeini, would use the example that we are musafirin on the path towards Allah. We're on a journey, we're doing safar. We're travelers. And when you use that example far enough, you know that in travel now there's hiccups and there's delays and there's stoppages, and sometimes, you know, you have to reroute your journey, sometimes you get there faster, sometimes. There's so many examples, you can really take that example really far. It really is a beautiful metaphor the Urafa of Islam use. In the beginning, opening chapters of this glorious masterpiece of Adab al-Salat, he says that even before you get on the musalla, know that you're constantly journeying towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the deen of Islam is a deen of harkat, of movement. One thing we can't be is, we can't be comfortable where we are. We can't sit there and convince ourselves, I've done enough. I'm good. I think at this stage I've earned heaven. And those are sometimes satanic waswasa, right? Those shaitan sort of evil whisperings to tell you, look, put your guard down, you're good to go, you've done enough now, relax, take it easy. How much are you going to pray? You've done your Hajj, you went for Arba'in now, you give your homes, you pray, you're good with your family. That's enough. Relax now, take it easy. Like, yeah, he's right. I'm good. Better than him, better than her, better than them. Remember, the first person to compare in this universe was Shaitan himself. Oh, ana khayru minhu. Allah doesn't like comparison, and tomorrow we'll talk about comparison. Because what I haven't touched yet, can you imagine, after 8 nights, is the second half of the Shakila verse. What? There's more? There's more? Yeah, there's more. Are you kidding me? Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So we are travelers on the path towards Allah. TK, yes, good. What is this home that we're leaving in the spiritual realm? Oh, so beautiful. He says a home, a beit, a maskan, ghar, home, is a place of comfort for us, a place of sukoon for us, a place that's familiar to us. I go there and I relax for a bit. When I'm outside the home, I might worry a little bit about my akhlaq, a little bit about how I'm dressing, how I'm walking, who I'm with, blah, 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 right? But at home, I'm a little bit easy. So I'm not as worried about how I am, even though I should be a little bit more, how I am with my family at home. It's a place that is familiar. I'll keep using that word. It's familiar. To travel is to leave home. If I came to see you before Hajj and you're sitting on the couch, there's no sign of a passport or suitcase, and you say, look, yeah, I'm midway through my journey. You're like, no, you're not. You haven't left home yet. No, I'm halfway there. You haven't left your home yet. At least get in the car and drive to Pearson. So start your journey. Leaving the home is when you start your journey. Imam Khomeini says that when you leave your spiritual home, it's the home that you are familiar with. It's the ego inside of you. It's the self inside of you. It's that nafs inside of you that has for day number one told you you're amazing, try this, love this, taste this, hear this, eat this. That nafs, that animalistic desire inside of you, inside of me, that automatically and instantly gives us this pleasure. That's our home, he says. That's where we are the most comfortable. That's where I am the most familiar. Now Imam Khomeini says you have to leave that home. Leave the ana inside of you and move towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This ana is where we are comfortable. The reason why it's called Jihadu Akbar is because this is that ana inside of me. When nobody was able to be there for me, this ana was there for me. When I couldn't get pleasure from anybody, this ana brought me pleasure through my eyes and through my tongue and through my ears and through other parts of my body. And this ana has been my best friend from day number one. Even an infant child knows what he wants and what he doesn't want. If that kid is sleepy, you're trying to shove a bottle down your throat, he'll take that bottle and say, I'm sleepy, don't give that bottle to me. You just see a bottle flying over your head. I don't think he's hungry. Right? At that moment, the ana is saying, tell them what you want, tell them what you don't want. And when you get what you want, it feels fantastic. And that ana gets bigger and bigger and bigger. The home gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Now it's furnished. Big TV. Man cave. You're like, oh, this is heaven. This is great. Come on for a very tough much this at DCC. Come on, like, oh, I'm relaxed. This is my home. This is my cave. Nobody can bother me. No one's asking me about bonfires. This is beautiful. Beautiful. I'm home. I'm familiar. I'm great. That's the ana inside of many of us. And Imam Khomeini says that spiritual journey is what? My yukhrij min baytatin. To leave that home of yours. And go towards where? Ilallahi. Go towards Allah. It can't be that you're traveling towards your ana and towards your Allah as well. You gotta make a choice. Allah says, I didn't give you two hearts. I give you one heart. It's up to you now what's in that heart. Okay, leave the verse up there, please, if you don't mind. Okay? So now when the Quran says, for the one now who leaves their bait, who leaves their home, let's go one step further. Back in the day, in the Prophet's time, maybe a little bit after the Prophet's time, when the Sharia was set, and the fiqhi rulings now started to apply, how the Muslims back then would determine whether or not we have traveled enough to be a musafir or not, whether or not now this salat that we are praying right now is qasr or not, they didn't have calculations, didn't know how many kilometers or miles, right? Didn't have any sort of, you know, these devices that we have today. They went based on two things. Number one, if you no longer can see the buildings of your town or city, or the homes or the walls of the home of that city, you traveled enough. You're far enough now where you're Salat al-Qasr. Or you can no longer hear the adhan from your local masjid. They're small villages, right? Small towns. It's not like these other Islamic countries right now, every now corner, mashallah, has a masjid. But usually there was one main masjid, from there came the adhan, the muadhin would climb up, and the entire village would hear it. The moment you can't hear the adhan or see the walls of the home, you've gone far enough. Now you're a musafir. Now you're traveling. And he says the same way. When you stop hearing the adhan of your praise inside of you, and you stop seeing the walls of the ana inside of you, when you begin to break that chain and you start to become uncomfortable, unfamiliar, you start to do things that I've never done before. I think it's time that I now go for Hajj. It's very hard if you haven't given khums for many, many years to give that khums out of your hand. It's very hard now to cover your hair if you haven't done it all your life. It's very hard to shut off the music when it's been such a companion for you throughout uni. It's very hard. It's very difficult, very unfamiliar, very uncomfortable. But that's what a musafir is. Leaving the sound of the adhan of your ana and leaving the view of the walls of your ana. Now, I can't hear myself, I can't see myself. You're traveling towards Allah and His Rasul. Why and His Rasul? Because one, Allah is the wahi of Allah, the Rasul is the application of the wahi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not enough, I'm sorry, that I understand the idea of spirituality and yes, remembering Allah. No, Allah says, look, you're traveling towards me and my Rasul, meaning my words and His application. Don't just take my words and say, okay, I will pray the way I want to pray. I will be modest in my dressing the way that I think it's modest in my dressing. I will donate towards Islamic causes the way I think I should. No, Allah says, I'm including my Rasul. He's already told you how to do that. He told you what modesty is. He told you what kind of khums I want. He told you how to pray, for example. You can't separate me. You can't separate the revelation from the recipient of that revelation. So he includes illallahi wa rasul. This verse is so powerful. Now, then he says, thumma yudrikuhu al-maut. Yudark. The Arabic on there is dark. Not mulaqat. It's not liqa. Now you understand what? You understand death. Now we know this death is not a physical death. This is not now me all of a sudden now my heart stopped beating and now, no. This death is the death of the ana inside of me. Mutu qabla an tamutu. Die before you die, the hadith says. There's idols inside of people like me that I need to kill and destroy before I move towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, let's look at the imagery. Historical imagery, we've heard these stories, looking through the Shakilazan lens. Fateh Mecca arrives. The Prophet enters Mecca now, it's his city. He's conquered it, announces immunity to Abu Sufyan and his family. And then he does two things. He summons his followers on the outskirts of Mecca. Wherever you see a temple of idols, remove those idols. Outside the homes, remove the idols. Any sort of big temples or big homes or big areas, you go here, you go there, you go here. And he tells Ali to come with him. We're going to those big guys over there. Because sometimes in order to destroy a big shaitan, you need a big amir as well, right? And destroys every instance of every idol outside the Kaaba, inside the Kaaba, inside Mecca, outside Mecca. All the idols are gone. Mecca is clear of idols, Ya Rasulullah. Bilal, now give the adhan. Symbolism. Remove the idol, then claim Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Not before that. That's why the creed that we believe on is La ilaha illallah. First, the La ilaha has to happen. That might take the entire year. The small g god has to be removed. Then the big g god comes in. And that's what this verse is talking about. That when now you darak and understand and come to an understanding that, wait a second, there are elements inside of my ana that's blocking my divine disposition. I have to kill those, remove those, destroy those. The chains and shackles of today, all the way back to my first lecture last week, talking about those verses from Surah Yasin, shackles up to their chins, because they refuse to look around them what's happening in the reality. So now when Allah says, for the one now who leaves their home, the ana inside of them, towards Allah and the Sharia of the Holy Prophet, not your Sharia, not my Sharia, not your ahkam, not my ahkam, not I think I should be okay if I pray this way. Nobody asked me for my opinion. I'm nobody to give my opinion. It's already been said. And in the process now, you have this realization that all this time, these shackles and shackles and shackles, I have to remove them one by one. Yudrikuhul maut. Now the ajr that Allah talks about makes sense. Now it makes sense. But again, one more point I want to make. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, please. And that point is that the reward in the verse does not come to you when you reach the destination. You're still in your journey. Nowhere in the verse does it say, when you reach your destination, then I'll give you a reward. No. Thumma, during that hijrat, during the journey, you realize, wait a second now, I need to sit there and remove this from my shakila. Remove that from my shakila. Allah says, during the process of doing that, I'll reward you. And that's the point I want to get to before Masaib. A lot of you are asking me, how? How do we do this? The first thing I have to realize, and then maybe all of you, you're way smarter than me, that this is a process. I don't have an overnight pill for any of you. If I did, I'd give it to myself first. I don't have a pill. I don't have a magic wand. I don't have an injection. There's a process. And God is telling us in this verse from Surah Nisa, verse number 100, that if you begin that process, I won't wait until you get to the destination. I'll begin to shower you with rewards the moment you step out of your home. But step out of your home. There are some people that are shackled and they don't realize they're shackled. Can you imagine a prisoner? My last point then, Masaib. Imagine a prisoner in jail looking at this guy. He has a J cloth, he has his Lysol wipes, and mashallah, he's just cleaning his bars. Look how beautiful my bars are. They outshine your bars and your bars. I have the best bars. Painting it, right? I don't know, making it nice and shiny, right? Every single day dusting it, right? Talking to it, naming each bar. Like, bro, you're behind these bars. You're shackled by these bars. You're drowning in these shackles and you're decorating them. Oblivious to the shackles. Because why? They haven't left home yet. They haven't traveled yet. They haven't man yukhrij min baytatin. They're still stuck in their ana. They don't even see the shackles. They think, oh, this is beautiful. This is how it should be. Meanwhile, the shackles get tighter and tighter and tighter. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, please. It's one thing where, just before Masaib, it's one thing where Imam Hussein had his own shakila to leave and say, I can't. Remember, I've said this many times. There were people in Medina who were of influence. There was somebody who was major. These people who were around the Holy Prophet, who was with Imam Hussein for the majority of his life, would say, Mawla, don't go. Just stay where you are. He would say, Tuffin hadha al-kalam. For lack of a better translation, I reject, and there's another translation I don't want to use, but I reject your qawl. Meaning not for a second did Imam Hussein entertain the idea of me sitting at home. Well, he claims to be the Khalifa. Same way Shaitan would never consider bowing down to this Bashar. The disposition of Hussein wouldn't allow him. It's one thing where you have or he has that shakila. It's one thing where he's able to get that to his family. That's special. To convince them or to raise them to such a level where, Baba, if you're giving your life in the way of Allah, I'm right beside you. And no matter how hard he tried to send them home, send them home, send them home, they refused to go home. At this stage now, the day of Ashura, the Ashab now have given their lives. And now the only ones that were left inside the army of Imam Hussein were the Bani Hashim. And the first one to ask permission to Imam Hussein was his own Ali al-Akbar. Every other member of the Bani Hashim, the children, the young, the youth, would come to Imam Hussein. He'd say, no, not yet. No, not yet. No, not yet. No, not yet. With Ali Akbar, he right away gave ijazat. How can I expect others to sacrifice when I'm hesitating in my own sacrifice? So many lessons on the plains of Karbala. So many lessons. We question and wonder why every year we do this, every year we do this. Others may question, that's fine. Sometimes we also question, why do we do this? Why do we do this? Maybe every year we pick one lesson, one flower from the garden of Karbala and apply it into our life. We can become over the years better people. If I'm expecting others to do it, I want to be first in doing it myself. The shahadat that was the most difficult, if not one of the most difficult for Imam Hussein, was Ali Akbar. To my fathers in the audience who have young Jawan son, many of you are here tonight. You know, I've oftentimes said, and you know, this is the way that I recite my Masaib, I don't know how else to recite my Masaib. Sometimes, you know, when you see young Jawan children reciting on a stage, right? They have their nohas and their shaki or their Quran or their duas and they're shaking and they're holding their paper and they're shaking and they're shaking. And beside that stage right there, comforting them, supporting them, telling them it's okay, maybe pointing to what verse to recite to, is their father. And while that child is very nervous, that father is very proud. That's my son on that stage. That's my son on that stage. That's my son on that stage. And afterwards, they'll say, "Ya, kya baat hai, mashallah, shabash. Aapne aaj beta ne kamal kar liya. Oh, he read so beautifully. Oh my goodness. And you're glowing with pride. That was my son who read. My son who read. My son who read. So be Ashur. Ali Akbar is giving the adhan. Hussein is not saying, that's my son, Allah. That's my son, Allah. Moments in this masaib, moments in this shahadat, where Imam Hussein reminded us that I'm a father like you. I'm a human being like you. I love like you love. My heart beats like your beats. Don't think this is robotic for me. Moments, moments in tonight's masaib and tomorrow's masaib, where Hussein reminds us how absolutely difficult these moments were for him. And as I said, the ravish was, Abbas, you prepare them and send them into the Maqdal of Karbala, I'll bring them back. Ali Akbar now, Baba, give me ijazat. You have my ijazat. You have my permission. But just like Abul Fazl did, and just like Ali Akbar did, Hussein told him, go to the khayma and the tent of the women and say your goodbye to your Puppi Yama Zainab. In that tent where there was women, Ali Akbar would now enter that. And he entered that khayma and that tent like a soldier dressed to now fight. His helmet was on, his armor was on, his sword in his hand. Papi Yama, I'm going towards the Maidan of Karbala. My father, stay with me. My father, stay with me. Hamid ibn Muslim, who was the rider on one of them on the plains of Karbala, he would say that I would see the tent of the women open as if someone wants to exit and then suddenly close. Open, exit, close. As if somebody wanted to leave the Khaymah, but he had a tough time leaving the Khaymah tent. Every time Ali Akbar wanted to leave the tent, somebody else would bring him back. Where are you going? You're Shabi Rasulullah. If we wanted to send our salams to the Holy Prophet, we would look to your beautiful face, Ali Akbar. Finally, Ali Akbar leaves the Khaymah. They're waiting for him to mount him on his horse. It's his 57-year-old father. His son in his 20s. I just want you to imagine these things. I said simply mount him on the horse. There are two ways that you mount somebody on a horse. Either you put your knee out and they step on your knee and climb, or you put your hands out and they put their foot onto the horse. Imagine now Hussein, his 20 some odd year old son, coming forward, knowing full well I won't see him again, stretches out his hand or puts out his leg. Ali Akbar climbs on his father's lap and gets on the horse. Hi, Hussein. So difficult. So difficult. Ali Akbar, go slowly inside the Maidan of Karbala. As you're riding inside the Maidan of Karbala, every so often if you can, just turn your face back towards the Khaymah. Let me see what I'm sending. And then before he went to the Maidan of Karbala, Imam Hussein did something very ajib. Look, when you're in difficulty, when you're in trouble, when you want to tell somebody how you're feeling, you tell those around you. You tell your brother, you tell your sister, you tell your wife, you tell your cousins, you tell those around you. When you feel like the problem is so big that even they can't understand, then you go somewhere else. The moment that Ali Akbar was about to go down into the Maidan of Karbala, Hussein raises his hand. Ya Allah, I want you to bear witness. I'm sending that individual. Khulqan wa khalqan is a Shabi of Rasulullah. Acting like him, looking like him. I want you to bear witness the sacrifice of me on this day of Ashura. Ali Akbar begins to enter the Maidan of Karbala. It's not so easy. You know, sometimes when you're sitting there and someone is in your vicinity, you can't see them, but you can feel their presence. Someone is beside me, someone is behind me, someone's in my peripheral. Ali Akbar is riding towards the Maidan of Karbala and he stops. He feels like someone is around him. He feels like somebody is behind him. He looks behind him, a 57-year-old father stumbling behind the Zuljanah. Slow down, Ali Akbar. Slow down, Ali Akbar. What is your hurry? Why are you so fast? He gets off the horse, picks up his father. They hug and they cry for a very long time. Baba, you gave me ijazat, Baba. And then that sentence to all of my fathers out there, if only you had a son like I have a son in you. This is not easy for Hussein. This is his blood. Gets on the horse, enters the Maidan of Karbala. If you don't know who I am, he says, I am Ali. I'm the son of Hussein. If you don't know who I am Ali, the grandson of Ali. And he begins to fight. And one by one, line by line, imagine now the blood of Hadir Karrar, the one who's trained Baba Fazl Abbas, enemy couldn't touch him as long as they were going one by one by one. Imam Hussein watching him from the Khaymah. That's my son, Allah. That's my son, Allah. That's my son, Allah. And then Hussein sees that Ali Akbar turns his horse and makes his way back towards the Khaymah. Now Ali Akbar is coming back towards the Khaymah. Hussein waits for him. Hussein waits for him. Baba, that sun is very hot, Baba. My armor is steel, Baba. If I could just get a drop of water, Baba. Imagine, I've always said this, when our kids come to us, Baba, I want this. No, not right now. Baba, I want this, maybe tomorrow. Baba, I want this after dinner. But if my child comes to me, says, Baba, I'm thirsty, Baba. Baba, I'm thirsty, Baba. Can I have some water? You'll stop everything and give him water. Hide the mazlumiyat of Hussein. He didn't have enough water to give his son. I don't have any water for you, Ali Akbar. He rides back into the Maidan of Karbala, the same level of thirst he rode away from. And now Umar ibn Sa'd says, don't go one by one. This is the Bani Hashim. There's Hashimi blood inside of him. Surround this young man. And so they surrounded Ali Akbar, closed in on him. Whoever had spears through spears, whoever had rocks through rocks, whoever had arrows through arrows. And one Maqta says that one Mal'oon comes behind Ali Akbar and strikes a baichi in his chest and rips the handle off. Now he falls from the horse. Again, look at his ajib way, Ali Akbar. Does not say, As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. Namata does not say that. He says his salams to his Bab in a very unique way. Alayka minni salam ya Abata. Meaning what? You've already accepted my salam, Baba. Basically what? Baba, don't come to the Maidan of Karbala, Baba. Stay where you are, Baba. I'm okay where I am. Don't come to me, Baba. You've accepted my salam already. But how could a father leave his child like that? Hussein sees Ali Akbar fall from the horse, gets on his horse, rides to the Maidan of Karbala, the Khak of Karbala in the air. Hussein's eyes are glazed, he can't see much, gets off the horse looking for Ali. Aina, aina Ali? Aina, aina Ali? Ilayya, ilayya, Baba. I'm right here, Baba. Hussein arrives at the body of his Jawan son. With every other shaheed, Hussein had a very khas way of doing things. He placed the head of the shaheed on his lap, cleaned the blood, cleaned the dirt, let them have their akhri ziyarat, and they would leave this world. But this is Ali Akbar. This is Ali Akbar. He didn't do that, Hussein. Hussein grabbed the cheek of Ali Akbar against his own cheek. Baba, there's pain in my chest, Baba. There's blood flowing from my chest, Baba. Hussein removes the hands of Ali Akbar. A spear lodged inside the chest, blood flowing everywhere. My Muslim Mawla lies down Ali Akbar on the plains of Karbala, attempts to remove the barchi from his chest. But every time the barchi tries to dislodge itself, the body of Ali Akbar would shake up and down the plains of Karbala. Hussein does something then, places one knee on the chest of Ali Akbar. One foot on the plains of Karbala, turns a little bit towards Najaf. Baba! The gate of Khaybar you ripped. The door of Khaybar you ripped. But come and see Hussein taking out this barchi out of the chest of my Ali Akbar. One last Ya Ali, and he pulls the barchi out. Ali Akbar leaves this world. Now Hussein has to bring the Shaheed back to the Khaymah. The Maqtal has two different ways. Akhari, that's it, my last sentence. One way is that he pressed Ali Akbar against his chest and dragged him back to the Khaymah. Another way he did it, he turned his back against the back of Ali Akbar, locked each arm, and dragged him towards the Khaymah. Zainab, come give me my portion for my Ali Akbar. Matim Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein.